Yeah, Maria, it looks like Donald's trying to use his business tactics of suing everybody to get his way to the political sphere, which is kind of not going to work.
Well, how would that play out if he were to bring a suit against Ted Cruz? What would that do?
It doesn't. It's nothing. It's just, let's move on. I mean, it's not possible.
You just think it's like an empty threat then?
Of course. This is how Trump rolls, to get in the news.
Yeah. All right, let me ask you about South Carolina, Governor. You know, there's a lot of people who say, look, if Donald Trump wins South Carolina, and he's still in the lead, right, it's off to the races. You can't stop him. How are you going to, you know, arm yourself with the right resonating for the people in South Carolina and beat Donald Trump?
Well, that's what I'm doing for the next 5 days, to make the case that we need someone with a proven record of disrupting the old order to fix things, to make things better for people. And that's my record as governor, and I have detailed plans to fix the mess in Washington. And this is a long-haul process we've gone through now. We're in our third of what will be 53 or 54 delegate selection processes all across the country. So I'm excited about the long-haul process. I believe that we're in a good position. Donald Trump is not a conservative, and he doesn't have a steadiness necessary to be president. He gets unhinged pretty quick. You can get under his skin, and then he kind of loses it. Sounded more like Michael Moore last Saturday than a candidate for the Republican nomination.
Yeah, you know, it's interesting, because over the last couple of incidents, whether it be in a debate or out on the campaign trail, it feels like you've gotten your sea legs. You're not afraid to punch back now and call out Donald Trump for the way you see it. What's changed in terms of the way you're acting and behaving in the face of all of this?
Well, it's hard to deal with a guy who talks over you, who shushes you, who shouts profanity in debates. It's not the normal candidacy. I'm running because I believe that we can grow the economy at 4% rather than 2% to lift people's incomes and to keep us safe and secure in terms of foreign policy. So this is a phenomena that I've had to adjust to be honest with you. But the reality is, he's a bully. And if you don't confront a bully, you get the same result, where he just pushes people around. And I find it amazing that most candidates keep quiet. Marco Rubio keeps totally quiet on this. And Cruz, until he got attacked directly, did the same. It's important for us to nominate a conservative in the conservative party, or we will just get wiped out in November.
And what do you think about the values of the South Carolina people and how you will tap into that on Saturday
yeah.
night? What's most important, do you think, this upcoming upcoming contest to the people?
Well, the values of South Carolina are family-oriented, strong work. They're proud of the recruitment of businesses into the state. Ultimately, the values of South Carolina are best expressed by Mother Emanuel AME Church, where these parishioners who lost loved ones because of a deranged racist forgave him in the most amazing act of grace and mercy I could ever imagine. That, to me, is South Carolina. Mm. And embracing those values is an important part of campaigning, respecting them and embracing them. And that's what I do, because I believe in them as well.
Now, let me ask you about your family and how your brother is helping you. Obviously, President George W. Bush hitting the campaign trail with you in South Carolina and sitting down with Sean Hannity last night in this exclusive. Let's listen to a bit of it, then I want to get your reaction.
Okay.
I'm not an expert in a lot of things, but I'm pretty knowledgeable about what it takes to be president. Since I wore one. Yeah. And he's got what it takes. He's got character, backbone, philosophy, vision. He can deal with crises.
Yeah.
He'd make a really good president.
Nice to see your brother again and your mother a couple of weeks ago. Tell us what that is doing for you right now, Governor.
Well, he was phenomenal yesterday in Charleston, and his endorsement as the two-term Republican president, the last one to have won since 1988, who happened to be my dad, is a validator about leadership. What my brother knows is that on the first day there will be a challenge. I don't know if it'll happen the first day or the first week or first month or first year, but the president will be challenged. It'll be an unforeseen event. It could be a pandemic. It could be a natural disaster or an attack on our country. And the question is, for people in South Carolina and going forward, the rest of the country, who has the leadership skills? Who has the steady hand? Who can make a tough decision? Who won't follow the polls? Who will run to the challenge, in essence, rather than blaming others? And that's what he learned as President of the United States, clearly, after 9/11. And I have those skills as well. I think I could be a president that would deal with a great challenge like that. And so his endorsement's meaningful because he's the only one that's done it in a long while.
Yep. Now, what about this Antonin Scalia seat, Governor? Let's talk about that for a second, because you know how the Dems are painting this, right? The Republicans are going to get in the way. It's every right of the sitting president to nominate his pick for an open seat on the Supreme Court. Harry Reid's out with an op-ed basically saying the Republicans are obstructionists. How do you see it?
Well, look, I mean, in the seventh year of my brother's term, Chuck Schumer made it clear that he was not going to support any nominee that may come his way that was nominated by my brother. And that was a year and a half prior to the end of his term. These guys play it both ways. I mean, it's both Reid and Schumer and others were very clear about trying to filibuster, including Barack Obama. And now, of course, we got a totally different situation. I think you're right. The president has the right to nominate. It's embedded in his rights in the Constitution. But the Senate has the right to not take it up or to take it up and vote them down. And in either case, we should not have another liberal justice to replace one of the great lovers of liberty and who believed in limited government. Anton Scalia was a constitutional superstar. And he'll be missed. And I think it's an important thing also as it relates to the campaign. This should be an election issue.
Yeah.
I'll make the case that if you appoint another liberal judge, the Second Amendment will be taken away in all likelihood, that you'll have religious freedom be repressed. And I think that's an important conversation to have in November.
Yeah, it's also really important for the people to understand how critical this election actually is, even more so than before, knowing this. Let me get your take on debt and deficits, Governor, because I'm watching the debate after the debate, and, you know, I mean, I like to go to the economy. That's a place that I like to ask questions about, but I'm hearing very little about debt and deficit. So when you look at your economic plan, how are you going to spend what you need to spend on the military as well and still not break the bank, knowing that we've got this $19 trillion in debt? What's the plan?
So, great question. I wish it was a question that came up in the debates more. High growth, growing at 4%, lessens demand on government and increases revenue far better than any of Bernie Sanders or Hillary Clinton's tax increase plans. Secondly, we need to reform our tax code, to generate economic growth. If you look at it on a static basis, tax cuts obviously take money away from government, but on a dynamic basis, you can get closer to par. And then finally, we have to have entitlement reform and reforming how government works. I'm for career civil service reform, shifting power back to the states, and entitlement reform. If you curb the growth of spending there, you can free up money to deal with the sequester cuts of our defense spending and move towards a balanced budget. I have people that have looked at our plans and believe that we could get to a balanced budget in the second term, and that is the only way you're going to deal with the debt is to reduce the deficit.
Well,